Welcome. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Church in Eugene. Rev Jen is off today. My name is Chris Olson, and I am your morning's worship associate. If today is your first time with us, we'd love to get to know you. Right after service, you're invited to our welcoming room, which is located in the south entrance. There's a bunch of letters cut out that say welcome right there. You'll notice that the words of our songs are projected onto the screen, but if you prefer a hymnal, you can pick one up. That is in the very back there. We have large print hymnals. We can also provide Braille versions. As you enter the sanctuary, and at any point at all during the service, you may write your joys and sorrows in the book, light a candle, or place a stone in the water. Oh, that table got moved right there. It's right there with the beautiful flowers on it. Those joining from home can write prayers of joy and sorrows into the Zoom chat, which will be open until the start of the sermon. And during the week, anyone can go to the pastoral care portal on the website and let our ministers know if you need some support. We gather in worship to find meaning and to live more deeply. Worship creates connections within, among, and beyond us, calling us to our better selves, calling us to live with wisdom and compassion. Whoever you are, whomever you love, whatever your image of the holy, we are glad you're here. We light the chalice, symbol of our Unitarian Universalist faith, with words from Lilla Watson. If you have come here to help me, you are wasting your time. But if you have come because your liberation is bound up with mine, then let us work together. And now let's say together the words of our mission, which affirm our shared purpose. Empowered by love, we transform ourselves and serve our world. Yes.
Working to build a diverse, multicultural, beloved community by our actions that dismantle racism and other oppressions in ourselves and in our institutions. These are the words of the eighth UU principle adopted by this congregation in June of last year. But how do you build a multicultural beloved community and dismantle racism in ourselves and in our institutions? This is not a simple goal, one that starts here and ends there. This is a commitment to change that we as individuals, as congregations, and as a faith explore in a more spiral fashion, passing each learning multiple times, learning and unlearning. Charlottesville, 2017, Pittsburgh, 2018, El Paso, 2018, Buffalo, yesterday. We are all on this spiral learning path and journey together, 4-year-olds, 40-year-olds, and 74-year-olds. Back in the dark times, BC, before COVID, and then COVID, when our worship and our faith formation were fully online, our children began their journey with teachers Mo and Kara. We used a UU curriculum developed in Charlottesville, Virginia. The lessons were designed to help our 6 to 12-year-olds explore how to become anti-racist Unitarian Universalists. We learned about slavery, about skin shades and melanin. We learned about empathy and action and the sad reality of the wealth gap in our country. We learned about segregation, civil rights, and more. We learned what many in our country would rather stay silent about and call critical race theory. As Unitarian Universalists, we call it history. Our children also learned how we as Unitarian Universalists of faith have been part of this journey since an anti-racist world for decades, how we marched in Selma, some of us not returning. So what are the characteristics and events that we must visit in our spiral learning journey towards dismantling racism? We've answered this question in the form of a talk show, which we'll present to you this morning. We are not Pixar, we are not equity actors. We are teachers and soft-spoken children on a journey. Hear what our children have learned and come with us. Come, let us worship together.
In celebrating our intention for creating a multicultural and loving community, we now enter a time of meditation. Close your eyes, if that is comfortable for you, and enter this time of prayerful meditation. First, consider yourself, your wholeness and well-being at this moment. Find that place inside of your awareness that is connected to all in a network of mutuality. We begin with self because the work to repair the world always starts here. Now, taking a breath in and out, acknowledge your inherent worth and dignity, and say to yourself, may I be happy. May I be well. May I be at peace. May I be safe. Let's widen the reach of loving kindness to our families and loved ones, the ones we were born into, the ones we create. We grieve those we have lost and send prayers to the ones who need some extra care. See them in your mind's eye and say to them, may you be happy. May you be well. May you be at peace. May you be safe. Now, consider the other spaces you occupy. Look around and notice. Do most of the people look like you? Or are you different from others in these spaces? Consider what language is spoken, what bodies and abilities are represented in these spaces, whether it is work, church, or in the media you consume. Now expand your awareness to those we may never meet, and yet they are kin, members of this earthly family. Let us bring to mind the courage and resilience of people everywhere who are fighting for rights or to not give up the hard-earned rights that are now at risk. Bring them to your mind. What images come to you? Say to them, may you be safe. May you be well. May you be at peace. And finally, bring to mind someone who brings up negative, uncomfortable feelings. In other religious traditions, this part would be called confessions of sins. We do not use that language very comfortably in Unitarian Universalist churches, but we do value truth, even when it makes us cringe. And we value taking responsibility for our individual actions and for our personal growth. So remembering, we all have implicit biases. Imagine someone who has sparked discomfort in you. Notice what is coming up in your body. Now as you breathe in and out, acknowledge their inherent worth and dignity. And the inherent worth and dignity of all people and say to them, may you be happy. May you be well. May you be at peace. May you be safe. Amen. Blessed be. Okay. I am a high school teacher. I teach social studies and sex education. To teach about history and sexuality at these times can feel like having a target on my back in the culture wars. But rather than reflecting on my experiences, I would like to center this reflection on two great thinkers, James Baldwin and Kimberly Crenshaw. The first thing we read in my class is Plato's Allegory of the Cave, because 2,300 years later, we still can't quite figure out what's reality and what's true or agree on that. After reading that, we read James Baldwin's A Talk to Teachers, written in 1963, and compare those two texts. I'm going to be sharing some excerpts from that. I want you to know I'm using Baldwin's original language, which is dated and not always inclusive. Baldwin introduces his talk. Let's begin by saying that we are living through a very dangerous time. Everyone in this room is in one way or another aware of that. We are in a revolutionary situation. No matter how unpopular that word has become in this country, the society in which we live is desperately menaced, not by Khrushchev, but from within. To any citizen of this country who figures himself as responsible, particularly those of you who deal with the minds and hearts of young people, you must be prepared to go for broke. Or to put it another way, you must understand that in the attempt to correct so many generations of bad faith and cruelty, when it is operating not only in the classroom, but in society, you will meet the most fantastic, the most brutal, and the most determined resistance. There is no point in pretending that this won't happen. And so here we are, still in revolutionary times, meeting the most fantastic, brutal, and determined resistance. Having never attended law school, I'm a teacher, not a lawyer, I came to learn about critical race theory the same way a lot of Americans did. When Christopher Rufo on the Tucker Carlson show challenged Trump to do something about what he saw as the threat of critical race theory, and Trump followed up with a series of executive orders targeting critical race theory. Orders later overturned when Biden took office, but the hornets had been released from their nests, and state officials in first Idaho, then Oklahoma, and now 36 states have made efforts to restrict education on racism, bias, the contributions of specific racial or ethnic groups in the US, or other related topics. But what is really at the center of this movement? Kimberly Crenshaw, law professor, scholar, mastermind of critical race theory, and self-described back talker, doesn't believe, and I quote, this is about a real difference in opinion. This is about a weapon they're using to hold on to power. And why do so many of these movements focus on schools? As Baldwin pointed out, this is one place the hearts and minds of young people are being developed. James Baldwin proposes again in a talk to teachers. He says, "The purpose of education, finally, is to create in a person the ability to look at the world for himself, to make his own decisions, to say to himself, this is black or this is white, to decide for himself whether there is a God in heaven or not, to ask questions of the universe, and then learn to live with those questions. That is the way he achieves his own identity." This sounds familiar. One's right to a free and responsible search for truth and meaning, our fourth principle. Baldwin goes on to argue, but no society is really anxious to have that kind of person around. What societies really ideally want is a citizenry which will simply obey the rules of society. If a society succeeds in this, that society is about to perish. The obligation of anyone who thinks of himself as responsible is to examine society and try to change it and fight it at no matter what risk. This is the only hope society has. This is the only way societies change. And so Crenshaw says we must talk back. Fact-based conversations about race must happen in our schools. And voices like Baldwin and Crenshaw's are a valuable contribution to this conversation, along with so many others. In 1935, in his book on Reconstruction, W.E.B. Du Bois wrote, "The slave went free, stood a brief moment in the sun, then moved back again toward slavery." This baton was picked up and further explored in Michelle Alexander's The New Jim Crow. And Baldwin, like Crenshaw, reminds us that the disagreements about facts are not the issue. The issue is identitarian politics. That is what is at the heart of this, particularly a rise in pundits and politicians using white nationalist talking points on their programs and in their stump speeches. In 1963, Baldwin said, "What is upsetting the country is a sense of its own identity. If, for example, one managed to change the curriculum in all the schools so that black students learn more about themselves and their real contributions to this culture, you would be liberating not only black students, you would be liberating white people who know nothing about their own history. And the reason is that if you're compelled to lie about one aspect of anybody's history, you must lie about it all. So we must educate ourselves and our children. And like Crenshaw says, we must then talk back. Talk back to institutions and systems. Talk back to school boards. Talk back to oppression whenever and wherever we see it."
As we mentioned, we're not Pixar or equity actors. If you have trouble hearing or understanding lines at home, we urge you to turn on your closed captions.
Good morning, Emerson.
Good morning to you, and a very good morning to our viewers.
Welcome to Black Lives Matter, a talk show for kids. We have a wonderful show.
Today's show is about anti-racism.
Now, actually, before we talk about racism, we might need to talk about race.
A perfect segue to our first guest. Please join me in a warm welcome for science!
I brought my whisper. Thank you very much.
How have you been, science?
I've been better.
Really? What do you mean by that?
People have not been respectful to me.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
Yeah, It has been rough.
We are super happy to have you, Science.
Thanks a lot.
We invited you here today to ask you about race.
Me? I have nothing to say.
What? Why not?
In science, race is not a thing.
What?
Race has nothing to do with science.
Say more about that.
It's all about melanin.
Melanin? What is that?
Melanin is a skin pigment.
What does it do?
It makes hair, skin, and eyes appear darker.
Just so I understand this, melanin is what makes people brown or black. Do white people have melanin?
Yes, they do, but not as much.
Huh.
That's why they appear lighter colored.
So, certain people have more melanin than others.
Yeah, you've got it.
What is melanin for?
It protects our skin from sun damage.
Oh.
It is also important for keeping us healthy.
So where did the idea of racial differences beyond skin color come from?
Social science, not me.
Wait, the idea of race, with one race seen as smarter and more capable than other races, is a part of social science, not science?
Yep.
Really?
I'll bet the Atlantic slave trade helped to create a racial class system.
That's right.
I'll also bet that it became a way for white people to keep power and money for themselves.
Yep.
That doesn't seem fair.
It's not.
So the made-up idea of race became a part of society and turned into racism?
Yep.
And racism is a way to keep power and money for white people and away from brown and black people.
Now you've got it.
That's really terrible.
Yeah, it totally is.
Phew, let's take a break and have a word from one of our sponsors.
Hi, Action. I heard that you wanted to learn about my new book that I just wrote, Peaceful Fights and Equal Rights.
Yeah, I did. I'm really interested. It sounds like a good book.
Do you know what it's about?
A little, but not really. Can you tell me?
Yeah, of course. It helps people join protests and understand equal human rights.
That's really cool. I feel like that's a really important topic, so I'm glad that you wrote a book about it.
Yeah, I even added this little quote, "Every voice matters, no matter how small. It's time to make a difference." And this other one, that is from Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., "We must pursue peaceful ends through peaceful means."
That's really cool. I'm so glad that you sponsored this, and I'm really glad that I get to meet you and hear about this book. Welcome back. Our second guest this evening is the foundation of anti-racism. Without it, anti-racism is simply not possible. For years and years, people were taught not to pay attention to our guest. But now we understand just how important it is. Please join me in welcoming empathy. So tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, empathy is when you understand how someone is feeling because you imagine what it's like to be them or stand in their shoes. People are grateful when you notice how they feel.
Sounds so fun.
If only.
What do you mean, if only?
There are people in the world who do not feel empathy for people that are different from them. They choose to only feel for people who are like them.
Really?
Really, and they treat people who are different from them as if they are worthless and not deserving of empathy.
Can you give us an example?
Sure. Suppose you owned an enslaved person.
An enslaved person?
That's right. There was a time when white men could own other people, people of color.
Yes, that's right. They also treated them badly in a way that they would never treat people like themselves.
They did?
They did, to be mean, horrible, and unfair to someone. You can't have empathy for them. Some people will be taught as young children not to have empathy for people of color.
Wow.
Yeah, crazy, right?
Horrible. So, empathy, didn't you say earlier that you were the foundation for anti-racism?
Well, actually, Emerson said that.
I did.
If you have empathy for people who are like you and people who are not like you, you will treat them the same and you won't treat them badly.
That's true. I understand what you're saying. Empathy is important.
Yes, it is, Emerson. I would like to thank Empathy for coming on our talk show today.
Thanks for having me.
Join me in welcoming the quality that, over the years, has helped us move to a more an anti-racist world. A quality that we can be proud of. Let's welcome Curtis!
Thanks so much for the lovely welcome.
Sure, we are so happy to have you with us today.
I'm glad to be here.
So, Courage, tell us something about yourself. How have you helped move us towards a more anti-racist world?
Well, Courage helped people of color stand up and speak out when they were enslaved. Courage allowed free people of color to do something against racism.
Like what?
Well, do you know who Rosa Parks was?
Yes, I've heard of her. How did you help Miss Parks?
I helped her do what she knew was in her heart was right, even though it was against the law.
Against the law?
Yes. Rosa Parks knew that everyone should have the right to sit on the bus wherever they wanted, and they should not be forced to give up their seat to a white person.
Oh yes, I've read about that law.
Yes. It was very unfair, and it took me courage to prepare her to sit where she wanted to sit and not where she was forced to sit. It took courage because she knew that she would be arrested.
She did?
She sure did. And she did not know how she would be treated when she was arrested, so that took courage.
I guess that does take courage. Can you tell us about others that you have helped?
Let's see. Other people who weren't in racism who were helped by courage. Oh! That would include people like Black Americans, Jackie Robinson, Thurgood Marshall, and former President Barack Obama. They were the first Black Americans in their fields.
Jackie Robinson was the first African American in baseball. Thurgood Marshall was the first Black Supreme Court Justice, and Barack Obama was the first Black president.
Wow, Emerson, good job!
Thanks, I've been paying attention.
And Courage also helped people like white Americans, like Unitarians and Universalists. Maria Weston Champion, Viola Liuzzo, and Reverend James Reed.
Not sure I know those ones.
There are people of faith, Unitarians and Universalists, who believe in the worth and dignity of people.
I think Viola Liuzzo and James Reed were both at the 1965 March on Selma and lost their lives.
That's right.
Looks like you were paying attention in faith formation classes, Grayson.
Thanks, I was.
Thanks so much for stopping by, Courage, to talk to us about, well, courage.
Happy to do it.
After these words from our sponsors, we'll meet our next guest, Wellscat.
Hi, my name is Silas. Are you here for the first time today? What's your name?
Okay, one, yes I am. And two, I'm Victoria.
Awesome, glad you are here. Love making new friends. Do you want to read and play?
I do. Do you read interesting books here?
Yes, we read and play because that is how we learn about each other and make friends. But we also learn religion.
What's religion?
Religion is what keeps us together as a community, our shared beliefs.
Oh, what do Unitarian Universalists believe?
That's easy. We believe that every person has a value. We believe that compassion is the foundation of being helpful. We also believe that each of us should take the time to find out what is true for them.
That's it?
Well, no. We also believe in protecting our planet, working for peace and democracy. Oh, and we just decided that UUs need to work to learn about racism and work to make our world anti-racist. That's part of our religion, too.
Wow, this sounds like stuff my family believes, too.
I bet I'll see you here next Sunday, too.
Hey.
We're back.
Yes, we are. Grayson, I am excited to talk with our next guest, Wellscat. While Wellscat may not be a characteristic that first comes to mind when thinking about anti-racism, it's one that has a huge impact on the lives of people of color.
How big? Well, let's ask our next guest. Please join me in welcoming and welcome. Welcome, welcome. We are happy to have you with us today.
I'm glad to be with you, Emerson and Grayson.
So, welcome. Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Happy to. Well, for a lot of reasons, including racist laws, it turns out that people of color have a lot less money than white people.
Really? How much less?
Well, white families have the highest level, about $170,000. Latinx families have the highest, about $21,000, and black families have the lowest at just under $18,000.
Really? That's a huge difference.
Yeah, wow. That's crazy. I hear you have a new movie about this. Can you tell us a little bit more about it?
That's right. I've teamed up with a few well-known actors to help people understand something that happened a long time ago, but is still having an effect today on people of color.
Interesting. Can we see a clip?
Sure.
It's not so white here. Look. Bad example. Ignore sweater dog people. A tote bag full of kale. You're killing me, lady. Okay, maybe this neighborhood is mostly too, completely too insufferably white, but that's just the way things are here. It doesn't mean we're racist.
I'm sure you're not, Ron, but the fact that so many suburbs are mostly white is no accident. It's the result of decades of racist federal policy that affect us to this day. Look.
Hooray, games!
What the heck kind of game is this?
It's Settlers of the Suburbs, Redlining Edition.
Cool!
Little Donovan, you be green. Ron, you're red.
All right, red, just like the name. Looks like I've got the advantage.
No, you don't. See, in the 1930s, as part of the New Deal, FDR created loan programs to help Americans finance their homes. But to decide who got those loans, the government created color-coded maps in which green neighborhoods were good and red neighborhoods were bad. This practice became known as redlining. Because of these policies, if you lived in the green neighborhoods, it was super easy to get a home loan.
All right, I can buy property.
But for folks in the red areas, no loans were available.
I can barely afford rent with this. There's no fair, the red areas are screwed.
Yeah, they were. And do you know why some areas were designated as red?
No, but I can guess.
Those were the neighborhoods where African Americans and other minorities lived, and redlining systematically prevented them from getting home loans.
Well, I know what. Just take my little guy and put him in the green neighborhood.
Sorry, that's against the rules. Early suburb developers like William Levitt instituted explicitly racist policies.
Levittown homes must not be used or occupied by any person other than members of the Caucasian race.
And the federal government itself encouraged developers to discriminate.
Developers, I want you to exclude non-whites.
The result of these policies is that from 1934 through 1968, a whopping 98% of home loans were given to white families.
Yes.
Okay, this is not fair. I did not get to pick what color I was when I started.
Yeah, no one does.
And it's something that more people need to understand. Redlining kept people of color from buying homes. Owning a house is one of the best ways for people to add to their wealth.
I see.
And that is why I wealth debt am a sad reality that must be paid attention to as we will work to create a fairer world for everyone. Believe me, I'm not happy that there is such a wealth gap between races.
Yeah, I'm not either.
That's just totally not fair.
Sounds like someone needs to run for a political office.
Great idea, Woka. Grayson, do you want to run for office and make changes?
Not a bad idea. We'll think about it.
And that is a great segue to our next guest. Let's welcome them, a characteristic that gets results. Put your hands together and welcome action.
Thanks for the very warm welcome.
Glad to have you, Action. I've heard many good things about you.
really hard to read these years.
Can you tell us a bit about yourself and the things that you've done?
Action is important because working for justice and fairness takes all of us. There is a lot to do, and we all need to do our parts.
I see. Can you give us some examples?
It's hard to name just a few actions, but I'll try. Actions can be big things, like running for political office, like Grayson is planning to do.
Hey, I've made up my mind completely.
Or we can do simple things, like making signs and attending protests. Protests can make a big difference. Have you ever heard of the Edmund Pettus Bridge and the March to Selma?
Not really. I'm only 11. Tell me about it.
Well, there was an important action. A march in Selma, Alabama, 57 years ago. At that time, there were a lot of racist and unfair laws against people of color to prevent black people from voting.
I thought that people of color had the right to vote after the end of slavery, right after the Civil War.
No. Voting rights were not granted to black people until 2 years after the Civil War ended. But many towns and states created reading tests and other unfair laws to keep people of color from voting.
So that's why there were these protest marches.
Yes, there were thousands of people there. Many of them were ministers.
You mean like ministers of churches?
Yes. And do you know what religion sent a huge number of ministers to the protest?
Thought I knew this one.
The Unitarians and Universalists.
No way.
Yes way. Have you heard of the March on Washington?
I'm still 11.
At that action, over 250,000 people attended from all over the U.S. It featured Martin Luther King, and it is still where he gave his famous speech, I Am a Dream.
Oh, yes, I remember that speech. How did it go?
He said, I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character.
That's an awesome dream.
It really is. But we don't have to join big, huge events like that to make a difference. We can join a group, like showing up for racial justice or Black Lives Matter.
Thanks so much for sharing your experience with us, Action.
And now, let's take a minute and thank our guests today. First, let's thank science for us the truth about what race is and what is not. Thanks for setting us straight, science. And let's thank empathy. Without empathy as our foundation, our work for anti-racism would be impossible. And courage. Without courage, we would not have the many brave women and men who work towards a fairer world. And wealth gap. It was so important to learn about you, a barrier to a living in an anti-racist world we are still dealing with today. And let's not forget Action. Without the dedicated people who worked hard and took action, we would not be this far in our anti-racism work. We are grateful to all of our guests for joining us today and our sponsors, Black Lives Matter, the publishers of the book Peaceful Fights for Equal Rights, and the Unitarian Universalist Church in Eugene. We are also grateful to you, our viewers, for joining us today. Grace and I look forward to seeing you again in the future. Black Lives Matter, a talk show for kids.
We'd also like to thank our hosts, Grayson and Emerson, and an additional thanks to Emerson, who edited our video. And to all the amazing kids who took part in our play, practiced our sound effects, painted our backdrops, served as our understudies, and learned how to be anti-racist Unitarian Universalists. All children, please stand or come forward. We are grateful. Congregation, this is the future of the eighth principle of our faith, working to build a diverse, multicultural, beloved community by our actions that dismantle racism and oppressions in ourselves and in our institutions.
Let's say our closing words together. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. And Grayson will be sharing the benediction with us.
Our journey toward the beloved community that tears down racism, that promises change, this journey is one that we, as people, as congregations, and as a faith, began decades ago. There's still much work to do. Let us learn over and over and over until we get it right. Go now. Learn. Make change. Take action. Live your faith in this world. Amen.